all those lovely things at the beginning because then I want to get out of the way and then we really enjoy what we've got happening behind me. So I am Michaela. I am the owner here at Soiree, and it is my absolute pleasure to be able to bring Tim Stone in tonight and Trio and to have you here. We do lots of different types of events and happenings here. We do wine classes and we change out the art on a quarterly basis and we get to celebrate live music. So if you need anything, certainly we are here. During the actual event, we don't tend to do a lot of table service. The reason why is because we don't want to be disruptive while we have the talent that we have here. So we are open back there. You're welcome to come back and there'll be some breaks here and there. And they have been working really hard. We've got a lot of really good things planned for tonight. So thank you, welcome, and cheers.
Words and music. We're going to start with the music. Well, I know. I guess we just started with some words, didn't we?
Yeah.
I'm so confused. It's hard to follow the format during election season. I just want to share this with you. Since it is election season, I want to say that trickle-down economy does, in fact, work every election cycle. That all that big money actually does trickle down.
Oh, yeah.
So that's, what, twice every 4 years it works. Right? It goes to our television people. It goes to our people on the ground, the flyers, the people printing up the banners. I share that with you. In lieu of that, we will start with a song by Dave Brubeck entitled In Your Own Sweet Way. Thank you.
I
When did you start on the guitar?
Man, I started, before the guitar, I had my grandfather's mandolin and a balalaika.
A balalaika?
Yeah, man, so I was kind of pinging around at it, around 7 years old, playing to these Russian balalaika orchestra records, picking up a tremolo with a fast pick, just playing with one finger, imitating the notes I heard on the records. That's how I started.
You? Wow. Now, Kevin comes from a show business family. His dad is partners with the only show club in Denver from the 50s and 60s, called the Taylor Supper Club, which was in Lakewood. And it was show business, right?
It was show business.
Yeah, it wasn't like a jazz club, or a blues.
But it was
bar.
Music.
Show songs.
They all played three instruments. They did comedy.
And tell them
they did shtick.
Tell them, yeah, shtick.
Shtick.
That's what Rush Limbaugh is, by the way. Okay. He admits it himself. So anyhow, tell them about your father. Your father was the one who got you into
My father was from Missouri, and my mother from Missouri. And my mother was a singer, and my grandmother was a child prodigy pianist, played at Carnegie Hall when she was like 13, 14 years old. But my dad, they got married, they moved to Denver for their honeymoon. They left, they said, we're not going to do it there. And we stepped right into what was called Taylor's Supper Club. I don't know if anybody here remembers. Knows anything about Denver, but it's well known.
Do you?
You put it in YouTube, but Taylor Supper Club, you could see them in 1964. And it was about a 7-8 minute video. So my earliest memory was my dad playing on the my mother's stomach, and all that kind of thing, and then on the headboard. And so I was always pulling up pots and pans and playing around when I was a kid. So that was my inception.
Right. We're talking about the very first beginnings, the very first inkling of, I want that. I want to go there. I want to do this.
And now I teach kids when they go, they want to learn, and they say, I'm not a drummer. And I say, take your hand, put it right here. Okay. And they say, well, it's beating. I said, that you're a drummer.
That's right.
And that's why I play myself, because I am a drummer.
That's right. And you sound damn good, I might add. My story is my father, World War II veteran, Depression era child, right? Knew all the Depression era songs on the harmonica, which was the instrument for a lot of those men at that time, boys in the 30s and 40s that he played the harmonica. And he actually picked up the chromatic harmonica, which means you could play all the 12 notes rather than like a blues harp. And although he couldn't change keys on it, but he knew Old Susanna, he knew Deep Purple, he all the great songs, East Side, West Side. And I grew up with that around the campfire, and that's where I developed my ear from him. And then later on, we went pawn shop, and then I got my first electric guitar. And I switched to bass because no one else in the neighborhood played bass, and I became the bass player. In my entrance to show business, we'll go there.
Hey, I tell you what, man, my first electric guitar, I painfully had to wait a year and a half from 10 to 11 and a half years old to get electric for my first acoustic guitar. It was a painful year and a half.
Paying it off?
No, just painful waiting to get one.
Oh, I hear that. Oh, yeah, my first bass back in 1965 cost $650. Can you imagine? That was expensive for a kid. Yeah.
Gold plated?
No, it's just a Fender Precision bass, man. I wish I still had it. That would be worth about $5,000. I have a piece of it, but anyhow, that's how it starts. There's something around, it's usually family that gets you, if you're lucky enough to have someone who's making music right there next to you in real time, right? Not on the radio or the record player, And that's what brought us. And it was like a... You had to do it, right? You just had to play.
My grandfather had those mandolins on the shelf, and he had these beautiful records with strings. It was like, what can you say? It was very exciting. What else would you want to do at your grandparents' house if there was nothing to do?
Right. They're not buying anything new. What are they going to do? And my next question before we go on to the music part to you fellas is, when was it that the jazz music captured your heart, captured your interest? I know there was a turning point for me. I had a band, a power rock trio. We rehearsed in the basement of my buddy's house. His father was an artist, painter, and a jazz fan, and he had all these records, and that's where I first heard it. He said, well, you listen to the MJQ, the Modern Jazz Quartet. Listen to this, it was Miles Davis, and that's how I got it. And I got inspired. And what really inspired me was something that really put me over the edge. It was a concert, again, in the live sense. I always think that live music so much more powerful than CDs. You only have, you're missing half of what's going on in music if you're only listening to records, Because there's something else happens when it's live. But what changed my life, somebody had given me Miles Davis Bitches Brew on my 16th birthday. And Miles came to town. And he was playing the record. He was playing songs from Bitches Brew. And I listened to it. My ears weren't very developed at 16 yet. I've been playing only for a few years. But I dug it. But he showed up. And the thing is Kevin went to the same concert. We were both 16. We were both there. We've known each other for a long time. We played together since, what, 13, 14?
13, somewhere.
And although you can't tell by listening, but we have.
Yeah.
And,
we shouldn't have told him that.
I know. It's like, oh, I should be off. But we heard Miles. And what happened was Miles played this title cut. And I had no conception that it was, in fact, a song, that there was framework there. I thought it was just all improvisation, and most of it is. 89% easily. But so that's what grabbed me. I went, oh, my goodness. There's a skeleton. There's a framework. There is a guide. There's a road map to this improvisation. I want to understand that. And that's what got me going with Miles. And that's when he was doing this electric stuff. I started really there and then backed up and heard him do the more swinging stuff like we started with. So anyhow, that's how I was really captured by jazz, although it was around your family, right?
My father was a big band drummer originally, so I mean, I grew up listening to big bands and some jazz. My real indoctrination into what that got me out of that, my mother would play all the great songs. She made me learn lyrics to all tunes, all the standards that were good. She said, if you learn the melody, you learn the lyrics, you learn the melody. And you will always know where you are in the song, you know. So, and she would play Carmen McRae and Nancy Wilson and Sarah Vaughan and Ella Fitzgerald and Mel Torme and Sinatra, and the list goes on. But for me, the real advent was when the first discount store opened up. It was before Target. It was called Arlen's. And it was across from the great Sloan's Lake.
Can I cut in for a second, Kevin?
Yeah.
That's where I got my first electric guitar.
In
South Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
And that's where I got my first Riverside jazz records, which were three for a dollar, because Riverside at the time was going out of business, and I was like 13, 14. And they were just phasing these out through Arlen's. And I had hundreds of records. I still have unopened Riverside. But I mean, that's where I learned about Bill Evans. That's where I learned about Stan Getz. That's where I learned about all the real hardcore jazz players, and got my indoctrination there. And to mention Miles Davis, I have to say, a year before that, maybe a year and a half before that, the piano player that was with Miles Davis in the concert Kim and I saw was Keith Jarrett.
And playing electric piano.
Playing electric piano.
Organ, right? Which he'll never do again.
Years before that, I saw him at the Denver Auditorium at Safe Place with Charles Lloyd, and he was like 20 years old, 19 or 20 years old. That was my first avant-garde jazz experience, to see Charles Lloyd.
And how about you, Mitch? When were you grabbed by the jazz?
Let me tell you about this, okay?
Yeah, tell me.
So I got my first electric guitar around 10, 11. My dad built my first amplifier around 12. Got in the newspapers around that time at the South Milwaukee Journal with my first rock band. We made a good splash in the newspapers. All the nursing home residents were complimenting us by going like this to the music. And man, I knew I was onto something good.
Yeah.
There's more. So anyway, so I got into the whole rock thing, the AM radio, everything that was on there. Anything with a jangly electric guitar sound was like a big turn on. Okay? Then I heard Hendrix, it was it. But the thing is, after that, I remember playing a gig one time, around high school time, out of high school time, and a gentleman that was into jazz says, man, you sure make your guitar sound like a cat. I went home thinking about it for a while, and I started thinking, how am I making my guitar sound like a cat? Screaming and meowing, and all, I figured out it was because all I did was bend the strings. Wow! Okay, and I thought, man, there's more to music than guitar like that. Then I finally started hearing my first Johnny Smith guitarist, who was here in Colorado Springs with us, and Wes Montgomery, and those kind of guys. I started hearing more of a melodic melody, chords. I started hearing chords really clean. And kind of, if I could just play this little segment here of Johnny Smith, sounds like this. I started hearing this kind of thing, and it started changing me. Sonny Stitt on the saxophone player, and that kind of got me into a bunch of things, which I'm kind of like, directions change, and I'm hearing different things these days, but that's kind of where it started for me.
Right. Jazz, improv.
Chord changes.
Chord changes. Beautiful chord changes. All right, well, we'll continue with the music. We're going to play a ballad entitled Angel Eyes, one of the prettiest songs written by Matt Dennis. I looked him up. This is like his most famous song. He worked as a songwriter. There usually always has songwriters and they write lyrics to it. And Kevin's right, really, if you want to learn jazz, you're supposed to know the lyric. You can't even play the melody unless you know every word that every one of those notes and every one of those beats is implying.
Should I go home?
Yeah, no. Romance is mush. This is from Lush Life. Check out this line. Here's lyric. I'm not great with lyric. I can't understand most of what the kids are saying. What was she saying? Taylor Swift, what's she talking about? Oh, you're talking about true love. Oh, you're 24 years old and you're telling me about love. Oh, yeah. Good. That's nice. I don't think I'll pick that record up right now. I don't even know where I was going. Angel Eyes, a lovely song. It has lyrics. I don't know it, but I was always going to give you Lush Life by Billy Strayhorn. Great, great piano player. Played with Duke. Duke actually worked him like a slave, from what I understand. And lyricist, a song called Lush Life. Now here's the last line. Romance is mush, stifling those who strive. So I'll live a lush life in some small dive, and there I'll be as I rot with the rest of those whose lives are lonely too. Now that's a lyric, okay? And I'm not sure, that was written before I was there. But anyhow, this is a lovely song. I know that little Jimmy Scott was a wonderful ballad singer, sings the hell out of this song. If you ever find a Jimmy Scott, little Jimmy Scott, Angel Eyes. Let's start with the improv.
Yes, please.
Feel free to.
Thank you. All I wanted to talk about, you know, we're talking about our influences in jazz. Things have changed. We're older guys. And now all the jazz is in schools. And most kids get introduced to jazz in schools, which is great. But if you're really chasing, in my book, if you're really chasing that jazz thing, the essence, the heart, Louis Armstrong and New Orleans thing, you know, all of your heroes in jazz really didn't go to school. And most of those heroes were black men also. And it's a harder world for those men, especially back then. And if you didn't play great, you didn't work, you starved, you're on the street. That's the difference in jazz now. I think it's like, yeah, you can get a degree, learn from these nice guys at this college. Nice guys. They won't yell at you too much. You won't slap your fingers. I mean, you know, back in the day with jazz, the cutting session in Kansas City, this is where Charlie Parker came up. Charlie Parker, the bird. He changed jazz forever with his virtuosity, alto player. And he's from Kansas City, and they had cutting sessions there. It was very competitive. I think America is like a football game in a lot of ways. And sometimes that's good. It makes you tough and strong. And that's the way it was in Kansas City, which was the jazz capital of this country back in the 30s and 40s, before New York City was. They had cutting sessions, and you go in and you play, and the cats, the best cats, would play, and whoever was playing all night long until like 7 o'clock in the morning, drinking hard and playing great, still was the winner of that cutting session for that week. And it all started again next weekend. And whoever could stand up and keep blowing great would win. And everyone knew that. So there was that competition, which I think we're lacking in college. I would like to see a little more tough stuff, like Outward Bound for jazz musicians. It's easier for white musicians also in this country to work. It's a fact, it's still true in my eyes. Anyway, jazz is a funny thing. And what was it, Ken Burns show told me in the 40s, it was 75% of the record market that was the swing bands dancing. And now it's 0.2%, 0.02% of the market. So things have changed. You know? And I think because jazz needs to change, we need to change things. Chasing the old bebop like we're chasing here, although here we put our own kind of stink on it, right? We do funny things to it. That's all we have left to do. But everything seems to be going completely improvisational now in the jazz world that I've seen. So let me, let's continue with another tune. I'd like to play a standard, a real one that Kevin requested. Everyone knows it, and it's overplayed, and it's silly sometimes. Miles Davis, All Blues, from his classic record, what was it?
It's because you asked that way.
Anyhow, All Blues, Miles Davis. What was it?
There's one secret. Can I share one secret?
Absolutely.
About this band and that Miles used to go in the studio, and many people don't realize that all the things that were a lot of his hits, he would walk in the studio and he would say, I wrote these changes down on the napkin at coffee. Roll the tape. And he would have these present these changes and different things to his band members. And these things became then recorded and then became immortalized and became what are called standards, like All Blues and So What and all these other things that Miles wrote. And they were improvising when they played them and came to them. The problem with academics these days, and it's okay, because for the last 50 years, they took All Blues and they take it apart and they study it and they look at it and they say, this is the way it goes. It goes like this. And the problem is, they learn all these things from it. They forgot the one secret ingredient. And that's the beauty of this band, is that they were improvising. They were improvising when they did that. And the academic thing wants to put it in a box and conceptualize it. And it kills it. It takes the life out of it. And art, you know, the indigenous art form of America is jazz. And by putting it in a box the way it's gotten put into a box, that's why it's gone down to the 0.2%. Because, but you go to Europe, they still appreciate it. They love it. But this country is not respecting its own art form. But a lot of that reason is the improvisation has been lost from it. I just have to share it.
There's a new Taylor Swift record out. Oh. No, you couldn't miss that one.
Thank you. Thank you.
Jazz is still today. Miles and his band loved Ornette's band. Everything they did after Ornette came out, they were copying him. They were trying to do what he did. But somehow that got whittled away, and Ornette's thing of all that, he had so much improvisation. He'd just play a melody and it was just open. He was very important. But you know, they didn't like him. There's a story where he was asked to go out and meet some fans behind the hall that he was playing at, and they suckered him, and they beat him up and broke his horn.
Wow.
Lots of stuff like that. But we have football, so we don't have to feel that violin anymore. We just watch it. Every Monday's Thursday and Sunday. I'm surprised they didn't put it on Tuesday during voting.
Okay.
In lieu of that, I'm going to ask Mitch and Kevin, and this is kind of comes from Michaela. She really likes it. She wants to know, we all want to know, about the most bizarre gig story you have. When it comes maybe to the negative feeling towards the jazz music or whatever you were playing. You have a story?
I have a story.
Do you have a story?
I got a story or two.
Who would like to go first?
Kevin.
And you know, nothing filthy, okay?
No. This is a real story. In the middle 70s, I was working in...
Are you that old?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Middle 70s, I was working, living in Dallas, Texas at the time. And toured to a little town outside of there called Sulphur Springs, Texas. And it was a little place by the highway. It was one of those little hotels that had a bar and a nightclub. And they invited us to play there, and we came in and played. And the first time we came in and played, they loved us. They thought we were great. They thought, these guys, they're so good, we got to have them back again next month. So they invited us back to play the next weekend, a month later, and we came back in. Second time, it was even better. They loved us. So they said, we're going to have you back again in a month. And the third time, we got there, and we're up there playing, and this cowboy picks up an ashtray and he throws it up in the bandstand and it crashes on the bandstand. And the waitress, we're looking like, what's going on? The waitress came over and said, they were called waitresses back then, no offense to the servers here.
The servers.
Anyway, she came over and told the cowboy, she says, those are my friends. You can't throw that ashtray up there. And he stood up and punched her. And knocked her to somebody in the bar. At which time, that guy stood up and went to punch him, and he fell into another table. And those people started getting out of punch. Pretty soon the whole room was in this fight.
It's like on television.
I mean, this was hardcore, and half the band ran out. I got down behind my drums, and the female vocalist stood up there with the mic stand with the big, I don't know if anybody knows, but a microphone stand has a big iron base, and she's protecting the equipment. And glasses are flying, and things, and it's going like this, and they put a big guy on the phone and another guy on the front door so nobody could come or go. The phone rang, and the guy says, everybody stop, the police are coming. And like that, this whole room stopped fighting. They picked up tables. Quickly, the waitress put out water glasses on the table, and within 5 minutes, the police came storming in, and they go, what's going on? We know we're... And people are sitting there bleeding. this is for real. And nobody would say, everything's fine. So how can you bleed? You gotta come back. Okay. And all this. And we went back, and the police left, and found out that this town had this ritual that had been going on for decades. And it happens a couple times a year, and they would have this Donnybrook, and they would have this town fight. And these were people that all knew one another. And as soon as the police left, you know, guy goes over and he goes, you got me a good one, Ralph. You know, you hit me upside the head, you knocked out my tooth. You know, I mean, it was fun, wasn't it? Yeah. And that was one of the most monumental moments. And they invited us back the next month. At which point, we declined. So I had to ship it.
With us musicians, every time we go to work, we have a whole new boss. We got a new boss. All the servers are in a pecking order above us. You have, you know, if you piss off a server, you're done.
Yep.
You gotta loan the club owner or whatever. But we all, you know, it's tough for us, you know. And most people aren't like this lady named Michaela here. They don't like that. They get all full of themselves. Oh, bands are begging me for gigs. I got all this power in my hand. Oh, they wanted to play for less money. I'm so important. Goes to their heads every time, swear to God. Anyhow, I'm going to tell you my story real quick. I have two of them really quick. They're just bizarre. And they didn't like the music we were playing. It was up in Lafayette. I'm playing with Mike Miller, who plays guitar with Chick Corea. The drummer, Russell Bazette, played with Tommy Bolin, if everyone remembers him, and other. And I think he played with Freddie Hubbard a little bit. Anyhow, we're playing at this little club, and there's a jukebox next to the bandstand, and it's playing. And we asked for it to be turned off. We're about to start, and the club owner goes, well, some people want to listen to the music on the jukebox, and some people want to listen to the band. So we're going to have the whole thing. You know, I'm 20 years old. I go, that's crazy. What'd you say? I said, well, you're fired. And he fired us, and that was that one. And simple, it's simple, you know. Show business is simple. Piss everybody off or nobody off, you know. There's just no black and white. You just can't do it any other way. Second one was Mr. Lucky's in Denver was a show club. I played with a blue-eyed soul band called Gangbusters back in the day. Wonderful guitar player Larry Wilkins, late Larry Wilkins, who played with Brian Auger and all these famous rock guys. Anyhow, wonderful player. And we've been playing there for weeks. Finally, the club owner comes in, and he looks and he sees that we're not using the stage lights. And we weren't using the stage lights because they were broken, all right? And we had actually brought in some of our crappy little lights, but we had some light. And he goes, well, how come you didn't fix it? He says to our piano player, Max Carl. And he goes,
"Well, that's showbiz," he says to the owner. All right, there's my story.
Before I start my story, next time I'm going to go first. I'm not going to follow Kevin Smith on this one.
Well, he had more blood than anybody can have.
And Kim Stone.
Thank you.
I'll share one little tidbit, though. And this was like I was out of high school and had a chance to play Red Rocks. Okay? Some big arranger had a famous tune called Butterfly Kisses. Pianist. Okay? So they put together this 11-piece band. And here we are, we rehearsed, and I'm playing Red Rocks, and I'm like, what am I, 22, 21? Jim Neighbors was there on the bill.
You mean the actor?
Jim Neighbors, the actor, man. From
Gomer?
Andy Griffith.
Gomer
Pyle. Jerry Reed canceled, unfortunately. And then there was this woman, Jody Miller. She had a hit, country hit, called, instead of King of the Road, it was Queen of the House. It was cool. I got to play with her and her guitarist. And I got to play with this big electric 10-piece orchestra with harmonicas, saxophones. I played my guitar with my teeth. Don't have that tooth anymore. But that's not the story anyway. So anyway, we got going. It was very exciting. I was so young. I was here. I am at Red Rocks on stage playing. You don't know about this kind of stuff, but sometimes I got a check. It was good money back then, too. It was like, I got a check for $225 in 1976 or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay?
That's good money.
That's not bad for back then. We won't go into that one.
Yeah.
But, so I got that. The check bounced. I never got paid for that glorious moment.
Well, that's... You got payment enough, I guess.
It was a glorious moment, man, but it kind of like, it was the beginning of, you know, what that business is about sometimes. You know, you don't know.
Yeah.
It's tough. Wow. It's a tough business, let me tell you. And, but we weathered the storm and we're here tonight. Thank you.
We're going to continue with a song written by Dizzy Gillespie.
Which one is this?
Ow?
Yeah.
Ow. O-W. Blues and B-flat. Put it where you want it, Mitch.
Hang on a second. Yeah.
By the way, I'm playing electric bass. You know, traditionally, this isn't the bass they started with. Traditionally, it was a tuba or a euphonium.
Yeah.
Was the bass in a jazz band. And then they went to a string bass, which is funny. Being the softest instrument in the group, hooked to the hip with the loudest instrument. I got that from Whit Marcellus. His new book is actually pretty humble. And then Leo Fender invented the electric bass. And when we saw Miles, we saw Ron Carter playing Fender bass. So, yeah, Miles made him do it. He didn't like it, but he did it. You know, and it sounded good. So anyhow, I'm playing the Fender bass. To me, it's just music. It's an instrument. In the minute you put a microphone on a drum set or a grand piano, put a pickup on a bass viol, it's no longer acoustic, okay? It's become an electric instrument. Just wanted to share that. So I'm gonna play this electric bass guitar on a jazz song by Dizzy Gillespie, who was Bird's buddy and partner. I got to meet Dizzy when I was on the road in the 80s with Spira Gyra. We did festivals in Japan, and we all traveled in buses together, and Dizzy was there, and Illinois Jacquette was there, John Faddis was there, all these guys. And Dizzy was a lovely man. And he liked his marijuana back then. And he could bring it in anywhere, because he never had to go through customs. Dizzy Gillespie would just walk him through. He had his marijuana right in his hand and walk him out.
Can I improvise the beginning of the song?
Yes, you may.
We talk about improvisation tonight. I'm going to throw the band off, but I'll never be able to do that. But I will start a couple bars by myself and have a whole new... Once somebody starts something different, it's a different deck of cards. It's a different reality. It's a different earth, man. It's a different parallel
reality.
It's a
different race.
Just when you think it's going to go one way, everything goes there. The minute you're caught by surprise, which is, I don't know. Well, we're still playing these songs, I guess.
Huh? I'm caught by surprise every time we play any of these songs. There's always something new.
I got that by Ringo, by the way.
You do it good, man.
I'm trying to figure out what the, I'm Mountain Dew and on the guitar here, so give me a second here, okay?
Thank you. Thank you.
73, And the owner there was a musician, and he would book bands in. And he happened one particular time, worked there for him for a year or two. He said he used to pay us, as long as we drove there in the snowstorm in Denver, and we got there, he would pay us even if nobody was there. But he says you have to make it here.
It's been a long time.
I'd make a long story short, he booked the Count Basie band. And at the time, most of the Basie band still was intact. It had the all-stars of Freddie Green was there. Sonny Payne was the drummer. Freddie Green was the great guitarist who played with Count Basie all through the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. Sweets Edison, Lockjaw Davis, Trummy Young was the... I don't know if you know any of these names, but these were... These guys lived together and traveled the country for years, for decades and decades and decades, and we knew when somebody was going to sneeze, they all did it in that band. And to watch that band play, and I was able to do sound for that band, and actually was able to record that particular band. To hear that band play was something else, and at the time I worked with a great legend by the name of Billy Tolles, who I stood at the back of the room with when we watched the Count Basie band. That's the only time I ever saw Billy weep. And I cried too, and we all stood back there, because the band was so sweet, and that's probably one of the last times you'd see something of that exquisite magnificence of people. Black artists that had gone through every kind of dilemma, been thrown out of places, practically hung, all the things that had happened. And they lived together, cried together, bled together, weeped together themselves. And it was just, I'll never forget that. Maybe we.
I thought you might share that. You got one, Mitch?
Yeah.
I'll tell mine first one.
You got me laughing. Go ahead. Have you been talking to Eddie?
Yeah, I can't get a word in edgewise with you. Go ahead.
What is it?
Oh, you're waiting for me. Simple. Simple. You know, not to brag, I'm playing Montreux Jazz Festival with, I think it was the Rivingtons. And Bobby McFerrin is there doing solo. I got to play with Bobby once. Mandatory jam session of George Ween. Put on all the festivals. Anyhow, Bobby's on stage and he's doing his and he's doing his thing. And then he gets two parts going and he splits the audience in half, about 5,000 people, splits them in half. Says, you take this part. I'm getting goosebumps just thinking about it. Can you guys see that shit? it's real. And he split the other half and gave them a part. And he got him going. And it was like, you know, a contra part, you know, almost like a round, but not quite like that. So there were different parts. And then he sang a third part. And when he created all that community from just people who were there, and he got everybody doing this thing, I weeped. It made me cry. It was beautiful. That was my moment, one of them.
Let me tell you mine. I was a young man.
Years ago.
You were a young
still
man.
Still am, right?
I am. It's all up here. I was at Red Rocks. On the bill was George Benson. But the young lady who had a great hit song at that time was Minnie Riperton.
Oh,
Minnie Riperton. I don't think I'll do that imitation tonight. But she sang that song, Loving You Is Easy Because You're Beautiful. But she got so high with her voice. It just went into the cosmic wiring of who we're all about. Yeah, I got a little wet in the eye, man. You know, it was beautiful. It was emotional, man. Minnie Riperton. Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah,
you know, those are the moments, you know. Anyhow, we sure are thankful to have all of you with us tonight. We enjoy telling our silly-ass stories.
And,
And I hope you come back to this wonderful place, because it's definitely art and they have lots of great things and obviously great work. And behalf of Kevin mentioned myself, we love you madly. As Duke Ellington said.
You're part of our story.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.